Today we have the pleasure of Dr. Philippe Lemercier, who will tell us about the SARS coronavirus 2 data and viral zone. Philippe, over to you.
Okay. Thank you. Right. So, do you see my screen?
Yes.
All right, so I will present you the SARS-CoV-2 in VAR zone. So VAR zone is about putting together the knowledge in textbooks, in PubMed, in whatever source I find, together with sequence data, and to provide it by easy access for the users. And just I wanted to highlight a little bit of the scale of virology. So in virology, you have kind of three scales. You have the molecular virology, which is what VAR zone is about, which tells about molecules, the cell, the virion, the replication, and everything that is inside in single cells. We have the clinical virology, which takes care of a human body or for veterinarian virology for animals. And you have the epidemiology, which really take care of the scale of the world, how the virus gets back and forth, and epidemic controls. So these three kinds of scales are working together to prevent these infectious diseases. But you will find there are implications for antiviral drugs, for example, which can be effective in molecular virology in cells, but not in clinical and so on. So we go back to viral zone. Okay. There. So in VAR zone, we have created a resource dedicated to SARS-CoV-2, which can be accessed in the homepage by this banner here. The resource comprises mainly two parts, the resource developed in VAR zone, which are there, and the external resources. We put links to many other places, which provides a lot of useful information. So in the VAR zone resource, we have the fact sheet. It's a classical fact sheet in VAR zone about the beta coronavirus genus. You have some more information on genome and expression, because coronavirus has very special ways of making messenger RNAs and translating them. You have a link to the proteome, the interactome, the curated interactome, the life cycle of the virus, and some data about drugs tested against COVID-19. So to start with the fact sheet, so in VAR zone, you have always this kind of fact sheet for all kind of viruses, actually. So SARS-CoV-2 is a beta coronavirus. It is a genus, it's a family of coronaviridae, and it's a positive strand RNA virus, which means the genome is composed entirely of RNA, which is positive strand. It means that the genome can be directly translated by ribosome. So when the genome enters the cells, it will be translated right away. We have the virion structure here. And you can see that we have also the marine hepatitis virus. So something you have to know about the beta coronaviruses and coronaviridae in the world is that in the first place, before the SARS came out in 2003, it was only pretty much animal viruses which were studied, and you have the hallmark of the model organisms was the murine hepatitis virus. So we have a lot of studies made at that time on this virus, and it tends to be a virus making hepatitis in mice, and it's when in fact a local breed in the lab of mice, it's very difficult to get rid of. It goes all over the place. You have to burn and disinfect everything. It's really a nightmare. So it was studied because of that, but it's a little bit different. Symmetric, there's a part which is kind of budding scar there. I will show you a bit more later, and there is a membrane. So this drawing has been made by using very nice studies of cryo-EM. And you can find in this paper that I link in viral zone, the study of the virion, which suggests that it may be not completely wrong actually, because when you look at cryo-EM, you have different kind of pictures. It can be a little bit elongated, and if you take a cross from this part, you have a round one, but it's not necessarily the real shape of the virion. And it's not also so symmetric as you see in the news and on other course. Now you have a part of the genome of the virion, which we will detail later. I made just a topology of the polyproteins, a little part of gene expression, a sketch of replication, which is entirely cytoplasmic, means the virus doesn't need the nucleus to replicate. And on the left, you have a lot of informations like links for databases. You can go into NCBI directly to find the beta coronavirus taxonomy and linking to with the sequences. you have also some dedicated resource, etymology, so different species officially recognized be part of beta coronaviruses. You see you have a lot of bats. you have also human coronavirus HQ1, which is a mild disease, a human virus known for a long time. You have links to reference strains with a sequence, a proteome, the genome. You have some part of the host. So you see that it's mostly present in bats for SARS and MERS. And human, cattle, pig, rat, moose are occasional also. These are RNA viruses. those viruses are able to infect many more than one species, usually. And I expect SARS-CoV-2 to be able to infect many animals. Actually, it has been shown that it infects cats pretty well. But it can go back in bat pretty sure as well. So this is not entirely human virus SARS-CoV-2, and this one also they can go back and forth from animals. The tropism is many epithelial cells for all the beta coronaviruses. some of them are making neurological disease, but not SARS-CoV-2, of course. You have different interactions for cell receptors. So you see the both SARS are using ACE2, but the murine is using another enzyme. And other, including human coronavirus, classical human coronavirus, using salicylic acids. Diseases are mainly respiratory in human, being SARS, MERS, or even HCoV-OC43. And I will go back to the drug later. So this is the classical fact sheet for viral zone. Now in the resource, we have added a lot more information. So I will try start with the coronavirus life cycle, which I draw to present the whole molecular biology of this coronavirus. So the virus starts over the infection by being outside of a cell. So the virion particle is completely inert. It just contains a genomic RNA and the information, but it's pretty much, you could make the analogy of a USB key. It's completely inert, it contains a program, but doesn't do anything on its own. But when the virion enters a cell, it will start to get translated, to produce protein and to take over the cell. So it's pretty much living inside the cell, but not living outside. So the virion contains this corona of spike protein. And the spike protein have two activities. They are mediating the attachment of the virus to the right cells. So the virus will enter the target cells. And also the fusion of the membrane to release the genome into the cytoplasm. The fusion activity is not active when it's synthesized directly inside the cell. And it's the same for all envelope viruses. They got a fusion protein inactivated at the start because if the fusion was active, it would make a lot of fusion directly before getting out and would completely prevent the virus from being expelled by exocytosis or whatever means. So the fusion protein is not active and it needs to be, the spike needs to be cleaved at a specific place for the fusion peptide to be active. And this in SARS-CoV-2, this is ensured by TMPRSS2, which is a host, a human protein, which would cleave the spike protein outside. It's present in the lung and will activate the fusion protein, which then in turn can make it function there. But SARS-CoV-2 have a difference with the SARS-CoV-1, which it has a arginine tract in the cleavage site, which could allow furin-like proteins to cleave it. So it would allow the variant to be active in many more tissues than respiratory tract, for example. This is not yet well defined. So the first step of the virus is an entry into the cell, which starts by attachment. So the spike protein binds to ACE2, which is an enzyme present at the surface of the some of the lung cells. This is the entry receptor. The binding will trigger by the cell endocytosis of this complex. So when the virus is endocytosed, it enters into an early endosome, which will mature into late endosome. And late endosome have a more acidic pH, a lot of things change inside. And this will trigger the fusion activity of the spike. The spike then make fusion between virion and endosome membrane, release the genome into the cytoplasm, which is uncoated. And then you get the genome. So the genome is about 30 kilobases long. It's the longest RNA genome of all virology, actually. And it's just a messenger RNA, okay? Just a simple messenger RNA, which will be translated first into two polyproteins, actually. So polyproteins are a way of viruses to create a lot of function by just having one open-ended frame translated. So it's pretty efficient. You just translate once and you can have up to 16 proteins there. For this, the virus need to encode protease to cleave this polyprotein into individual chains, which have each one a different function. So the purpose of the polyprotein is to establish the first infection and to create double membrane vesicles. So these are the two part of the polyproteins which create that. So double membrane vesicles are a special feature into the cell induced by the virus, which actually is there to hide the replication intermediate. Because the virus is RNA, when it replicates, it will create a minus strand RNA, which will anneal into a double strand RNA, okay? And double strand RNA never happen into modern cells, be it in bacteria or in eukaryota and whatever others. It's a hallmark of virus infection. So all these cells have strong antiviral system, which recognize double strand RNA and will completely shut off any virus producing double strand RNA. So the virus needs to hide itself against these defenses. And with positive strand RNA viruses, it's done by creating a lot of vesicular system, which will actually hide the double strand RNA intermediate from the detection system of the cell. So in these vesicles, you will have replication of the positive genome and transcription of new messenger, which in turn can produce new polyproteins. The cycles goes on, okay? So you get amplification of the genome. But also, it will create subgenomic RNAs, which are RNAs, kind of spliced RNA. I will explain later how it works. But these RNA are then encoding for all the structural protein, which will allow encapsulation of the genome, budding through the Golgi membrane, with all the protein and then getting out by exocytosis, okay? Also, there are non-structural protein translated from these sgRNAs, which somehow dysregulate host immune response. Okay, so this is for the life cycle. Now we see a bit more of how the coronavirus express its genes. So the genome is about 30 kilobases, and it's comprised in two main parts. The first part encodes a polyprotein, which is 16 actually chains. And the second part encodes structural protein and few host modulating protein, which are all expressed by subgenomic RNA in the second phase of the infection, actually. So the first phase will produce these ones, and the second phase will produce that ones, okay? So there are different ways of being translated. So when the virus enters, the polyprotein is translated because it's the first opening from there. You see that the protein have two ways to be done, and it's differentiated by ribosomal frameshift. So it's a special feature in which the ribosome on a special sequence will stall and sometimes go back or force one nucleotide. Thereby, it will start to translate in a different open reading frame, which is ORF1B there, and make this longer polyprotein. So we have the two kinds of polyprotein produced, the longer being less abundant. So the reason for that is that this ORF1B encodes the polymerases and helicases on a proofreading system, everything for replication. And in pretty much all viruses, the RNA polymerase are down-regulated compared to the other proteins, because you need a lot of these proteins to take care of the cell, to really handle the defense system. But this will produce double-strand RNA. So you need a little bit, just enough to not produce too much. And if you overexpress these proteins into a cell, it will go right away in antiviral state. So the virus have found a way using a very simple system to produce less polymerase, but everything it needs to take care of the cell. So the polyprotein topology is like here. You see it's you have three parts, three chains, which are transmembrane, and these three ones will produce a double membrane vesicles interact together. So you have the small polyprotein and the biggest one with RGRP. Okay. The first part is host modulation protein interact with host, and SP1 is actually shutting off the translation system of the cell by inducing messenger RNA, cellular messenger RNA degradation, but not the viral one. So by doing so, the virus take over the translation system for himself, and the cell cannot translate anymore. It also shut off the cell defense, because cell defense relies on creating new messenger RNA for antiviral proteins. But if these are not translated, of course, the cell cannot defend itself. And in the second part of the infection, the virus will produce subgenomic RNAs to actually translate all these open RNA frames. And this is done by a special feature, which looks like splicing, but it's called discontinuous transcription. Actually, there are sequences which are called transcription regulation sequence, or TRS, which are present pretty much at the start before the structural open reading frame there. And when the polymerase, RNA polymerase, will replicate the minus strand, it can stall on this sequence and directly jump to the leader TRS, thereby producing a deletion and it's kind of splicing. So the more replication there are, the more these subgenomic RNAs are created. Of course, it's always just a possibility for the polymerase, but it can go through, so it will continue to make the full-length genome as well. This smaller negative strand RNA will be replicated into positive strand, double strand RNA, and then will produce messengers, which will in turn allows translation of all these proteins. So you see in coronaviruses, when you look at open unit frame, you can see a lot of open unit frame presence, but only some of them can be really translated by this system. If you don't have a TRS, it's not likely that open unit frame is translated. Also, the virus relies of presumably on Liskey scanning to produce sometimes two different peptides from the same messenger. Liskey scanning happens when the ribosome doesn't start on the first AUG, but we go find another one. So it's not very likely, but it happens. Then you can produce the 7B or the 9B proteins. So you have, from what we know on SARS, there are nine messenger RNAs. So eight of them are subgenomics. Could be more. It's not really well known so far, but for this, it's pretty sure. Now we have a part of the proteome. So VARzone is produced by the Swiss Prot Group of Swiss Institute of Bioinformatics. And our main activity is to annotate for UniProt Consortium the proteins. And we did that for SARS. But we have a problem is that the UniProt release rate is about 2 months right now because it's very complex database, a lot of computational have to be made for each release. So the virus we annotated in January will not be available until the 20th of April, which is pretty long, and it will be the first run of annotation. Of course, a lot of annotation have been added since now. So UniProt has reacted by giving a pre-release entries. So these are, you see, last update is 6 April, so they can be updated very quickly and independently for using classical release of the whole of database of UniProt. But it gives access to this annotation to everyone. So you have in this pre-release SARS-1, which is a CVHSA, and SARS-2 there. So if you click on that, you will have the protein of SARS-2, SARS-1. You have also 9 human proteins, which are also updated for their interactions with SARS. And it, other than that, it's classical UniProt annotation that you can access to. Here you have RIA with the different reactions and the different features. I will not go into details for that. So in VARzone, you can directly access by clicking also on this to the same site specific for SARS-CoV-2. You have some notes which gives you insight of the main purpose of these proteins. For example, an interesting part is budding. So viruses have pretty much two kinds of ways to bud out of the cell. It's escort dependent. Escort is a system which allows the cell to bud out vesicles. And many viruses are using that. But some viruses like influenza, coronavirus, or flaviviruses are using a different system. So SARS-CoV-2 using that. Here you see influenza, so a mark of this budding. And actually it's a budding that involves varoporins. It's just small pores that will, by depolarization, allow the pinch off of the budding virus, and which actually released from the membrane. But you end up with a virus which is not completely symmetric, to you kind of scar of budding there, which is also a mark of coronaviruses. Okay, so I will go back to the interactome. So the interactome represented there is what we have annotated in UniProt, which means it's an interactome which is curated and for which there is a clear function in the interaction, and whose interaction have been also experimentally well established, okay? Because you can find much more interaction. You have that in the external resources. For example, there is a large-scale interactome in bioarchive, a Krogan paper, which write about 300 interaction. You have virus hostnet also, which shows a lot of interaction from SARS. You have 600. It's for SARS-1, SARS-2003, but those are not interactions for which it's well established any function on anything. So we don't annotate them yet. We wait for more experimental confirmation of this. So for that, we have just a few of them. In light green, you have those shown up to happen for SARS-CoV-2 and CoV-1, and for the others is for SARS-CoV-1, which by similarity, we think it happens also in the same SARS, because the two viruses are very, very close actually, only on spike protein, on some NS8, it's different. So, okay. You can access to the protein also by clicking there. In UniProt, if you're interested. And you have the paper, which one of the main paper, which tells you where come from the annotation from. We see SAO2. Okay. So this is for the interactome, which will be updated as we have much more information. And now we are going to speak about the drug. So I've plugged the drugs on the replication cycle. But before that, I just want to highlight things about antivirals in general, okay? So to treat the viruses, we have pretty much vaccines and antiviral drugs. So these are the treatment approved so far. So you see for human viruses, we have 17 viruses for which we have vaccine, which are approved and used in human. Okay. For antivirals, we have only 9 viruses. So it's lower because it's actually much more difficult to find antivirals than to make a vaccine. To make a vaccine takes about 2 years, maybe less if you push things up. But for antivirals, for hepatitis C, it was about 20 years of research. For HIV, like 10 years, and it has been much better right now. And it's very difficult. The reason is that the virus actually is alive inside your cells, and it's using your cell system to replicate, to translate, and so on. So it's quite difficult to find a molecule which specifically will attack the virus. Each virus is completely different. So you need a specific molecule against HIV, which will not work against hepatitis C, and so on. So you get different set of antivirals against each one. When for vaccine, you can use the same kind of carrier for different vaccines. It's not the same for antiviruses. And also, you have, in this scale of virology, you have a lot of ways to make antivirals in cell culture. At this scale, it works very well. For example, I told you a double-strand RNA is strong inducer of antiviral system. If you put double-strand RNA on cells that will go into antivirals, you will prevent cells from growing. But this cannot be used in clinical. In clinic, if you make this, it's toxic. So you have a lot of ways to have antiviral working in cell culture, but would not be effective in clinic. You need something to be not toxic in human or organism you want to cure, and also to work at a low dose, because you in cell culture, you can put a high dose of drugs, but it cannot be the same in a whole organism. So this being said, we go back to the anti-COVID drugs. So before COVID-19 came out, we had no drugs which are really working against coronaviruses. Coronaviruses are still much studied for veterinary diseases, but so far we have only remdesivir, which gave some good things in experimentals. With the COVID-19, the whole community of research go wild by finding antivirals and put that on cells, and it ends up with a lot of trials, which I will describe the main ones there. But they are still working in cell culture, but in clinics, it's not yet very, very well established, okay? So in anti-COVID system, you have neutralizing antibodies, which can be monoclonal or covalent plasma, this will neutralize the virus. We call that neutralizing because antibodies can bind the virus but not prevent it from entering the cells. You need a specific antibody which is called neutralized to do that, okay? Then you have camostat mesylate, which is a drug which inhibits TMPRSS2. So this drug could prevent this activity in the lung. So no cleavage of the fusion protein, so no fusion activity, okay? You have also the chloroquine, which is a repurposed drug. It against malaria, and chloroquine activity is mainly to focus into the endosome and prevent the maturation of the endosome somehow. So the virus cannot then make fusion, because if the endosome is not mature, the fusion protein cannot activate itself to make the fusion. You have also humifenovir, which is a recent drug against influenza. It's not pretty much recognized in Europe and in US as active against influenza, and it would prevent fusion. It has been tried as well, but does not work. So chloroquine is still in investigation. You have some drugs which act on the protease to cleave the polyprotein. So if you stop the protease from doing these jobs, of course the virus will be completely stopped. And there is a polyprotein as well in HIV. And these drugs are a repurposed drug from HIV antiprotease, okay? But the problem is that HIV protease is an ASP protease, but in the coronavirus, it's a TOR protease, which means there are completely different ways of doing the cleavage. It's not the same active site at all. It's not the same reaction. It ends up with the same, but it's not the same reaction. So these drugs will not likely be effective. And actually, the first two ones have been shown not to really work. So they do their job in cell culture, but for many reasons, maybe side effects, but they are not working to prevent the protease active of coronavirus. It seems not to be happening. Now you have, at the level of transcription replication, you have a nucleotide analog, which can stop the polymerase from working. So we have remdesivir, which a drug came from cancer research, seems to be very active in cell culture, but the drug is not yet ready to be used in clinic, seems to be. So there are new formula of remdesivir coming out that could be promising, but it's not yet there. You have a favipavir, which is an antiviral against influenza, which was actually tested in influenza, but not very good results. It was tested against Ebola with no good results, and now it's tested against coronavirus as well. And at the end, you have antibodies, tocilizumab, which are against IL-6, which have some effectiveness to treat the disease, because COVID-19 create a dysregulated host immune response, which can leave you to death by your own immune system. So this protein, this antibody, will prevent IL-6, which is an inflammatory cytokine, to act, and will make you... So it's not really antiviral, it's anti-COVID, okay, system. There are many others, like heparin, which in some cases can be effective also. So here you have the main drugs are listed there. You get a link to Wikipedia, which have some general insight of the drug. You have also a link to Campbell, which gives you a lot of details, like the max phase of using clinical research and the formula, everything you need to know, and a reference as well, which gives you a paper to relate to from this antiviral. Here, an external resource, I've put a treatment of vaccine tracker, which is made by Mikkel Institute and still keep up to date. So it shows you what's happening against COVID-19. So you see Here you have 79 vaccines tested. You have 18 antivirals, antibodies. You can access to more details there. Then you get a list. These are all the antibodies. And you can go up to antivirals. So this is favipavir, for example. So they tell you a lot of details, the clinical trials used, some published results, and so on. So it's interesting to get these details, okay? at the end of the day, antivirals are not pretty much ready. It takes really years and years to find good antiviral, good formulation of molecules which are not toxic, which are still working in a human body. And I personally expect vaccine to be the first one to come out, and many after antivirals. But I think we will have to wait for the vaccine to be there to kind of solve the COVID-19. Of course, antivirals race is on, but don't expect to find an antiviral like that in 2 or 3 months. It's going to be hard. In this site, Internet Book of Clinical Care, you have a lot of data on clinical aspects of COVID and on antiviral therapies. Okay, a very nice picture is there, which shows up the stage of illness. So you see in the time course, you have kind of 3 stages of COVID-19 with host inflammatory response. So that's where anti-IL-6 therapy can be, or anti-IL-2 can be effective to prevent the death, actually. So there is hyperinflammation phase, the phase in which you have shortness of breath. So they give you symptoms, signs, and the potential therapies there, okay? But actually this site provides a lot of information on clinic with, for example, you see how you can look at the disease directly and so on. Okay, this is it for resource in ValZone. Now, for external resources, you have the Uniport, which has already shown up. There is a very nice video made by Britt Klossinger, University of California, which explained the molecular virology of coronaviruses. You have a site for epidemiology, very well done, which is made by people part of Swiss Institute of Bioinformatics. It's Nextstrain. So they show you up all the sequence on a phylogenetic tree of the SARS-CoV-2, show you the geography as well, and the diversity, I mean, the different mutation you can find in these viruses. Here you have the opening frame of the virus. You see it's not much diversity actually for RNA virus. It's not like influenza mutating all over the place. And the reason is that there is a proofreading activity associated with the polymerase. It's only the coronavirus have that. All the RNA viruses are producing a lot of mutants, but coronavirus are the only one which have a proofreading. Proofreading means that when the polymerase make a mistake, it can be corrected. Okay, it happens in all the polymerase of the cell, but not in classical viruses. Coronavirus have that. Okay, you have a site for PDB structure, so PDB make a special resource for COVID-19 in which you can access to all the structure they have already, and you see it's pretty much a lot, 110 structure for SARS-CoV-2, which is really amazing. So you can access this by this link. Trying to go back from PDB, okay. Swiss model is also part of Swiss Institute of Bioinformatics, and it offers a special site for SARS-CoV-2 in which you have model of all the other proteins which are not crystallized yet. So for example, you have NSP2, papain-like protease, and so on. So it can be also very interesting to get. This is World Meter, so it's more epidemiology resource, which gives you, in other words, all the number of cases. You see, we are about 2 million cases diagnosed. Number of deaths also, which are diagnosed as deaths produced by SARS-CoV-2. And you have details by all countries. So it's live data. So you can see from yesterday how many deaths happened in USA and all the countries, how many in the world, 5,000 deaths. It's really crazy. And you can look at the country with all the data, and you can see the daily new case here in Switzerland. You see it's really going down, which is pretty nice to see. Active case going down as well, but yeah, the deaths are still stable. It's normal because there is a lag between the deaths and actually the onset of disease. Okay, Cellosaurus is a website which also from CBIO, Swiss Institute of Bioinformatics. It tells about cell culture, every data on cell culture, and it gives a site for SARS-2 cells, cell lines that have been used to grow, and those that are not suitable to grow. Okay, so it gives you a lot of details. If you want to grow SARS-CoV-2 in whatever cell system, you can have a lot of information there. And then medical data, COVID-19, which are already presented previously. Okay, I think I've went to everything there. So I will stop, and if you have any question, it's the time. Thank you.